श्री भारद्वाज, चेयरमैन एटॉमिक एनर्जी रेगुलेटरी बोर्ड, श्री हेमंत शेट्टी ऑफ केमटेक फाउंडेशन, आवर होस्ट, वी हैव सेवरल कलीग्स एंड फ्रेंड्स फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एटॉमिक एनर्जी, फ्रॉम इंडस्ट्री, एंड मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंटली in this particular meeting we also have our student friends who are the kind of prime stakeholders for today's engagement. Chemtech Foundation has been conducting programs on various sectors, nuclear energy being one of them, nuclear energy, thermal energy, chemical technology, renewable energy, water, and so on and so forth. And this actually provides an opportunity for industries to showcase their products, their capability, their plans. This also enables meetings of this kind where you have again people who are interested in bringing in results of research into technology for national development, people who are implementing several government programs, industries who are actually the prime movers of the economic progress of the country, and all the other stakeholders, including student community. So while there is an expo going on, there is also this discussion on some specific aspects that are important for that particular sector under discussion. In our case today, we have this focus on nuclear energy in this meeting. And then this inaugural session is of course common for the meeting which has the theme towards greater competitiveness in accelerated deployment scenario in case of nuclear power. And then in parallel there will be this student outreach program where several colleagues from Atomic Energy would engage with students throughout the day. So it's a sort of just like on the expo you have engagement more oriented towards business. In this meeting or this twin meeting, we'll have a more intellectual engagement, and of course there could be back and forth the deployment of technology cannot happen in vacuum. They have to happen in the context of viability, in the context of competitiveness, so on and so forth. So meetings of this kind have their own importance. Today, this particular session is focused, it has a very specific theme, and as I said, towards greater competitiveness in accelerated deployment scenario. First, a little word about atomic energy. Atomic energy in India is of crucial importance because India is a unique case in the world where in terms of the unmet energy needs, India's requirement are the largest in the world, because it's of course a very large population, and its economy is growing at a much faster pace, and that means that there is be growing energy need or growing demand for energy. And if you just look at the in sort of in equilibrium, whenever energy increase cannot go on indefinitely, there will be some saturation at some point of time. And even though it would be probably wrong for us in India to aim at a saturation level corresponding to the countries, the advanced countries in the West, the countries in North America, Europe, Scandinavia, there the per capita, even if you talk in terms of electricity consumption, they talk about per capita energy consumption upwards of 10,000 kilowatt hour per capita. And if all countries or all countries of the world have the ambition of reaching at the same level, in fact, that much energy simply does not exist on this earth. But you don't require that energy. If you look at the correlation between human development index and per capita energy use, at around 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita, beyond that, the human development index doesn't change, it's flat. So in fact, there is no need for us to aim at a saturation level of energy availability more than around 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita. In fact, the advanced countries in the world will do better in cutting down their energy consumption from wherever they are to around 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita. Their quality of life will not change. It will remain at the same high human development index as it has been. And on the other hand, a lot of resources can be released for the poorer countries of the world where there is a huge energy requirement. But I think that's utopian. It's not going to happen. What is the next best alternative? The next best alternative is to all countries to try to be as energy efficient as possible, reach a minimum level, in this case 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita, to realize a human development index that is comparable with the best, and then find the energy resources and deploy those utilization of those energy resources for meeting the national requirement. In Indian case, even if one were to say that, okay, we'll go to only 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita, which will correspond to roughly 5 times larger energy use from where we are today. Today our electricity generation is primarily coal. We say we have plenty of coal. We have. We also say that, well, our coal will last 100 years. There are some others who say, no, 100 years is all right, but all that coal is not mineable. So maybe our coal will last 50 years. But 50 years at the current rate of consumption. So if our consumption is 5 times larger, the coal which otherwise would last 50 years would get exhausted in 10 years. So an energy resource as large as coal would appear very small when India reaches its own kind of targeted level of energy consumption. And same thing is true with other. In fact, we have hardly any oil here. There is some gas. There is some hydro. So that much about the non-renewable energy resources. You go to renewable energy resources, of course, we are very favorably placed. We have plenty of solar energy. And so, in fact, in theory, you can meet all our requirement, energy requirement, by exploiting solar energy. We also done very well in our country in the context of wind. In fact, wind happens to be the largest component of renewable energy basket in the country. But the problem is, all renewable energy sources, except perhaps the geothermal, which we don't have any significant resource in India, all renewable energy resources are, first of all, they are not available round the clock, and they are very intermittent, fluctuating. Now, while you can certainly make use of these so-called diffused energy sources for decentralized energy use, and that's an important need that can be met, but you also need what one may call the base load generation which can run 24/7, and because unless you have a significant capacity for base load generation in the grid, it would be very hard to stabilize grids. One may say we can have storage, one may say we can have the modern controls, have smart grids and stabilize the grid. In principle, yes. But then that would cost, under today's projections, that would cost as much capital investment as the investment in the energy source itself, perhaps larger. So, I think we need a large enough baseload energy generation system which will be sustainable. And as I told you, the largest source, coal, is also not likely to be sustainable. And this is where there is the importance of nuclear energy. Nuclear energy, particularly thorium, and particularly when you use these resources, nuclear resources, in recycle mode, they offer a potential much, much higher than what coal would offer. And you can run baseload generation using these nuclear energy resources, and a good combination of nuclear and solar, to my mind, offers a perfect solution for India's energy requirement going forward in future. And that is where I think we need to position nuclear energy as far as Indian program or Indian energy requirements are concerned. Department of Atomic Energy has been kind of making continuous efforts to grow the nuclear energy capability and supply possibility in the country. This technology has been, as all of you know, been bound by a lot of restrictions, a lot of embargo. But then, thanks to the scientific might of Indian people, all that has been overcome. India has become self-reliant in nuclear technology. But just becoming technologically self-reliant doesn't help. We also require resources. And India, unfortunately, doesn't have too much of uranium, which has to be the starting point of nuclear energy. when you expand the uranium use, you can perhaps irradiate vast thorium quantities that we have, and then start making use of thorium. But you can't start with thorium. And uranium being in short supply in our country, that was another constraint. Today, even that constraint is over because we now have a more liberal international civil nuclear cooperation. And so we can access uranium from outside. While we can expand our nuclear power program based on domestic technology, we also have access to imported technology for setting up reactors based on technologies developed in other countries. So we now have a situation where the constraints which were existing earlier for nuclear energy are no longer there. But having got thus far, the route to expanding nuclear program seems to have till recently, till about a couple of years ago, it seemed that it's not taking off. There have been various reasons. The Indian nuclear liability law was one reason. That has been ironed out now. The foreign vendors who were expected to start operating here, for some reason, they have their own problems. We're expecting reactors built by Westinghouse to be set up, but then Westinghouse has its own difficulties. We're expecting EPRs to be set up, but then Areva has got its own difficulties. Now EDF has come forward. And so we still hope that the reactors to be set up by these two groups which were expected to set up will start taking shape on the ground without too much of a delay. The third technology coming from abroad was the Russian technology for VVER reactors. That, of course, there is some progress happening. Apart from the two VVER units, which were the construction for which had started earlier, are today operating well. The construction for two more units is on, and there is contract for also two more units. So there are, including the two operating units, we're at the moment talking about six more VVRs, and maybe more will follow. So the point is, in spite of overcoming all the constraints that were there, there seem to be some new constraints, and the program has not picked up momentum the way it was expected to. And it was in this background that the recent initiative of Government of India to sanction 10 700 megawatt PHWRs to be constructed in fleet mode was, I think, a very bold decision, a very welcome decision. And so, including the two PHWR units, 700 megawatt PHWR units that were sanctioned earlier in Haryana, we have sanctioned for 10 more PHWR units. So we are now talking about a domestic program of 12 more PHWRs to be constructed in fleet mode. And also the reactors coming from imported technologies, I'm pretty certain, would also see the construction being done in fleet mode rather than the earlier mode in which we're talking about being done in pairs. Now, this is a new paradigm, and I think a forum like this, where you have people from industry, it's important that we discuss this. NPCIL at one stage was actually engaged in constructing 9 nuclear reactors simultaneously. And at that time, NPCIL did construct these reactors in reasonable time schedules. We need to pick that kind of momentum, or perhaps even even faster momentum, to be able to realize the expectations that the country has made in respect of nuclear energy. Government has done its job, according to me, and if this program for some reason falters, if there are delays, if there are cost overruns, or for that matter other issues, I think then it is for, I don't think we can blame the policy makers. The implementers have to blame themselves. And I think it's important that, quite apart from the government, the Department of Atomic Energy, the Nuclear Power Corporation, they will do whatever they are supposed to do. But as a community action, there must be open public debate, public discussion on these issues involved. And it is in this background that this particular meeting has this theme towards greater competitiveness in accelerated deployment scenario. When you construct reactor in fleet mode, you are talking about very high financial stakes. A delay of one day could be very expensive. And because when you're talking about large programs, the decision making, the governance issues, the quality control issues, ethics in management, quality, all these issues have to be very carefully, systems have to be carefully put in place so that things move in a clockwork fashion on a large scale. And it is in this background that today we have invited speakers from industry, some from nuclear, but most from non-nuclear, who have experience of implementing program on that kind of scale, because there will be lessons from what they can share, and it can be carried into the implementation of atomic energy program. When you do program on a large scale, the risk management assumes a very special dimension. There could be issues of what one may call, should there be a problem which is generic in nature, arresting the risks arising out of such problem becomes a huge job when we are implementing reactors in fleet mode. And so it's important that such issues do not arise at all. And I think we need to discuss what is it that is involved in ensuring that such risks do not come. You know, if you are constructing a reactor 2x2, if there is a problem, you can implement the correction in the next pair and do something about the current pair where the problem has arose. When you are implementing on a large scale several units simultaneously, and should there be a problem, there could be a serious issue, and such things have happened in past. I personally know about nuclear, that such things have happened. And so we need to make sure that there is this importance to standardization, there is this importance to making sure that, in terms of sourcing of materials and all. They may be following the same specs, but then just little variation that can happen because you have changed the source, and there may be some unknown issues that might creep in, which is not a big issue if you are talking about a single project, but it could become a huge issue if you are talking about a fleet mode of construction. There are also issues related to financial risks. So I think it's important that we discuss all these issues, because these are new dimensions to program implementation, and I think we should remain aware and conscious about this. The third session during the day, the idea is to devote it to look at optimum energy mix. And that is because, see, you may say you must have different sources, but finally, the growth would be dependent on what's the tariff. And also looking at what's the direct cost or direct tariff, and if there are any indirect issues, even that would dictate, and I think we should be aware of it. For example, I'm sure many of you must have read, in Germany, for example, there has been a great emphasis on renewable energy, solar energy. And now we know that, say, for example, solar energy has become very competitive. But when the penetration of solar energy into the grid becomes larger, the percentage share of solar energy in the grid becomes larger, you need to add a much larger system cost. And these costs, as I said earlier, could be as large as the cost of solar itself. This has been actually experienced in some of these countries. In Germany, I read that they shut down some of the nuclear power plants, expecting that that will be replaced by solar. And good part of it has been replaced by solar. But in the overall electricity, the role of coal-fired plants' contribution has been in fact larger, and emission in Germany has gone up. Of course, going forward it will come down, I'm sure. But at the moment it has gone up. So I think we need to look at these things on a system-wide basis. And so the idea is that in the third session we'll promote a discussion following a lead presentation, and then have it discussed between a panel and of course all the participants present in the audience. So that's broadly the theme of this meeting. Let me put in an additional comment for the benefit of our young student colleagues. See, so far we talked about only electricity. Now, electricity is only a very small part. See, of the energy that we use at the user end, electricity may constitute maybe 15%, in some advanced countries maybe 20%, 25% of total energy use. We expect electric mobility to kind of come into existence in a big way. When that happens, maybe the share of electricity at the user end may go up maybe 50%. But remember, there is a much larger, or when electricity becomes 50%, an equally larger mode of energy supply that we need, which is outside the electricity, non-electricity supply. This could be in the form of petrol, diesel, it could be in the form of gas, In some cases, in the old thing, it could be in the form of coal. And in rural India today, it is in the form of biomass. In fact, today, rural India uses, or the role of biomass in the total energy basket at the supply end in India is as large as around 20-25%. So the point I'm making is that we need to, you know, we are all conscious. We say that, well, we have to reduce our emission. We say that we need energy for our good quality of life. Now, just making a program and providing electricity is not going to solve our problem. We need to address this issue of cooking. For example, today you have this great attempt going on to replace gas for cooking in place of biomass in rural areas. There could be also other, for example, many industries, they require heating, and you require to provide energy for that. Now, if you look at the non-electricity energy supply, in India, most of it is in the form of hydrocarbons. And the liquid part of that hydrocarbon, almost 80-85% of that we import from outside, because we don't have enough hydrocarbon available on Indian landmass. The use of, just like electricity demand or electricity use will grow, the use of other energy forms also will grow. So there are projections that the import bill, energy import bill of our country, which is already very high, import of hydrocarbon or import of crude is the largest foreign exchange outgo in our country. Of all the items that we import, energy import constitutes the largest item. And that may go up by as much as around 7 times in next couple of decades. And the question is whether India will be able to afford that kind of money having to be spent for energy imports. And then we are talking about reducing the carbon footprint. So the challenge, and that's essentially for the younger community, is can we produce hydrocarbon or can we produce fluid fuels, which we also require in addition to electricity, out of non-fossil resources? See, today we get fluid fuel by import of crude, or for that matter, gas. Can we produce these materials using solar energy? Can we produce these materials using nuclear energy? And the answer to that question is actually yes. There is research going on all over in terms of making this possible. And I think, for example, solar energy, we are used to photovoltaic. We are used to solar energy leading to production of electricity. According to me, it is much simpler to concentrate solar and produce heat. And you can do that all within indigenous technology. See, solar energy, photovoltaic, most of it is imported, just like oil is imported. You want to produce solar thermal at high temperature, that also is a technology, but it is well within the Indian capability today, not tomorrow, today. Using that heat, you can actually split water. You can produce hydrogen and oxygen. Or you don't have to go that far. Even if you are producing electricity, you can use that electricity for steam electrolysis. You know, water electrolysis you can do and produce hydrogen and oxygen, but that requires larger quantum of energy. But if you do that at high temperature, if you electrolyze steam, then the energy consumption becomes much less, and so you can produce hydrogen at a competitive cost. In fact, you can match with the cost of production of hydrogen even today. And there are technologies in the making for this purpose. There is also this technology for hydropyrolysis, for example. You can take biomass and pyrolyze it along with hydrogen, and you can produce fuel. And this is now a fuel which does not contribute to CO2 emission, because biomass is CO2 neutral. It is based on use of consumption of CO2, and then you produce same quantity of CO2. And in fact, if you use hydrogen, you produce much larger. The calculations are that if we deploy all the biomass that is available, for example, agri residue, which is burned and it causes particulate pollution, particularly in Delhi, you use that biomass to convert that into fuel through hydropyrolysis. And now this technology, Shell has come up with technology where you can hydropyrolyze this biomass to produce what they call drop-in fuel. You produce petrol and diesel and straight away put it in your car. So imagine the transformation that is possible. Imagine the transformation that you produce, even nuclear, you can produce nuclear energy at high temperatures. There are high temperature nuclear reactors. So you can use electricity, you can use heat from nuclear reactors, you can use heat from solar energy, produce hydrogen, use biomass, and produce the fuel quantities, which I'm pretty certain would be a substantial replacement for imported crude. And of course, you will get advantage in terms of the carbon footprint, meeting our Paris commitments, and so on and so forth. I can say this from here, but implementing this requires technology. Choice is you wait for the technologies to be developed elsewhere, and then they will come. Of course, you will have to pay for it. The other choice is you develop this technology here and implement, just like atomic energy was done. And I put it to you that our, in terms of urgency, our urgency for solving this energy problem is much higher, much stronger than any other country, as I said in the beginning. And so we must accelerate R&D to address these energy issues in specific Indian context. So I thought I must make this point for the young community which is here. You are going to be, of course, exposed to several other aspects of atomic energy during the day, and I'm sure you'll find that very interesting. I also appeal to some of the industry colleagues who are here that while, of course, we want to do business with commercial viability, but let there be some little prioritization which is consistent with the basic Indian needs. And you can do good business while keeping those priorities at the right level. And I think it's important that we pursue a path that addresses our problems, and that also will keep India on the forefront. Wherever we have done our own problems, solved ourselves, we have remained at the forefront. I think it's time for us to move from the so-called trader's mentality to entrepreneur's mentality. That's the modern times. And there has to be this investment in new ideas, investment in new technologies, doing something which is more consistent with our requirement, even if it's a little more difficult, because eventually it will pay up. And I think we need to pursue that path. And as you would recognize that while today the main theme as far as the nuclear energy session is to address how to do things fast when we are implementing such large program, but I think we have a much larger and much broader canvas to deal with going forward. Thank you.